How to tap into the financial power of the internet. Terry. Welcome to the Affiliate Business and Marketing Workshop. Today you're going to learn how to develop an affiliate business that generates a real income for you. We're really lucky to have Anik Signal for us. He's going to be our business professor for today. Anik is the founder of AffiliateClassroom.com and DominateCRChengines.com. Daily, Anik teaches affiliates how to run their businesses. I'm going to be your host for the workshop, and my name is Terry Telford from TheBusinessProfessional.com. The first thing I'd like to do is thank you very much for joining us today, Anik.
Anik.
No problem, it's my pleasure.
Terry.
Thank you very much. Can you start off by giving us your background, where you come from, and a little bit of your history?
Anik.
Sure. I'm currently a college student. I'm only 21 years old. I started internet marketing when I was 19, so it's been about 2 years. I was a pre-med major when I first found internet marketing. I was studying at a completely different university, and I was studying to become a doctor. I quickly found myself getting away from that field, and I can say that since as far back as I remember, I have been a business guy. When I started looking into the business world, I realized that was where I needed to be. So, I made a drastic change over to a different university, and I joined their finance program. This is my last semester, so I'll be graduating soon and going full-time in marketing. For 3 years I worked as a financial planner. I was the youngest financial planner in my entire branch for the whole company, which is the third largest firm. So, I've had some decent experience in that sense. From there I began getting very active in my internet marketing because it was such an easy business to run with school. So, slowly I've gotten away from finance, and I don't work for that company anymore, and I'm pretty much full-time in marketing right now.
Terry. Excellent.
So, how has your offline experience helped you online?
Anik.
One of the first things that offline experience did was prove that business was what I wanted to do. Another thing that it taught me a lot about was because I was in the sales business, I was sitting down with people one-on-one, so it taught me how to speak to people and I learned what people want. This directly came into my internet business because I realized that there is no human touch online, which could be a problem. I'm very good at getting back to people, and all of my skills of customer service and knowing how to deal with people have come from my offline experience.
Terry. Excellent. Now that you're online, what kind of an income are you generating?
Anik. As of this month, I finally hit the monthly income to be a six-figure earner. So, if this keeps going, I will earn six figures this year, and you're looking at someone who's technically doing this part-time. I work about 2 to 4 hours a day because I have a load of schoolwork and I like going out with my friends. So, I don't even know what's going to happen when I go full-time, but I'm very excited about it.
Terry.
Beautiful. So how did you come up with the concept of affiliate classroom?
Anik.
It was pretty simple. When I started doing my own affiliate marketing, it took me a while to really find a system that works for me. I bounced around from all of the main books reading about affiliate marketing. There are about 4 or 5 main types of marketing that you could use, so I was so confused and it took me so long. Affiliate marketing, I feel, can be harder than any other form of internet marketing, because you're a little bit limited on the traffic you can get. So, I started doing my own research because I wanted to find solutions. Basically, I came up with my own system that is working really well for me. One thing in my system that I found other systems were lacking is a very step-by-step approach. The idea of affiliate classroom came when I found that there was no place for affiliates to hang out. There are a lot of good ebooks and guides, but there was no real place that affiliate marketer could come and talk to each other about what they're doing. So, the whole idea of building a community came to me. Then, I realized that I wanted to have a unique service where we had a software system where the student can get step-by-step instruction and get completely tracked on our website so they know exactly where they are and what they're doing. That's when the idea for affiliate classroom came about.
Terry.
Excellent. You just mentioned that there are about 5 different affiliate models that you can use.
Can you share those with us?
Anik.
Sure.
One of the main ones that I have used is to pretty much set it up like a merchant. You just have your one-page sales letter, but it's more of a pre-sale page.
What I did was to set it up like a FAQ page. I only do that promotion for something that I've used and had a lot of success out of, so it can be a personal story. It's set up as one or two pages, and at the end, the person is clicking out to the merchant's page to buy. That's one system that's worked fairly well for me.
It's selective, you can't use it in every niche.
I've used it in the internet marketing niche quite well because I have personal endorsement stories. The second kind is what Google Cache is known for, which is where you have an affiliate link, you write a quick Google ad, you set it up and it goes straight to that site.
It's now changed into the third strategy that I would use, which is setting up a landing page.
I would have a newsletter or a zine. I'd have a quick one-page blurb that at the bottom would have the name and email slot. What I would do with that one is buy traffic from places like Overture and other pay-per-click engines, then I would drive traffic to an opt-in, build a small list, and then market them other affiliate programs from that niche. The fourth one is the one that I think is the best, which is the content business model. In this one, you're building a content website with hundreds of pages of articles. Each article is pre-selling some form of affiliate link. So, with this, you're really going after search engines.
You want something that will get you free traffic from the search engines.
The next strategy is almost the same as the fourth one, but with an added element, you build a community. So, you may add things like a forum to your content website. You can have free resources as well. You'll be pretty actively involved in a community website or in a content website. A lot of people might spend a month on it, have a lot of articles, have 100 or 200 pages, optimize the website, put it up to a nice degree, then never touch it again, or at least until the rankings fall or something like that. But, usually people will do number 5 if they are very passionate about the niche and so they don't mind being actively involved in the site every day.
Terry. Excellent. You mentioned that you have a system that you use for your affiliate programs. What's that system?
Onik. I like to focus on the content sites.
So, if you join Affiliate Classroom, we show you all of them, but the one we offer all of the step-by-step coaching is, you go from choosing what niche, then going through a whole process of creating articles, setting up your website, site optimization, then we walk you through all of the forms of promotion such as pay-per-click, solo ads, ezine ads, offline marketing, forum promotions, and all of that stuff. So, out of the 5 I gave you, it's more of a number 4.
Terry.
So, what is the USP or unique selling principle of Affiliate Classroom?
Onik.
I would have to say that it's the step-by-step module that we built. It took us about 7 months to perfect it. It was a lot of work. The whole site is completely programmed. So, the USP would be that we have very unique software built into it that provides all of the step-by-step, then it tracks you. You could be running 10 different affiliate programs in 10 different niches all at the same time, and our site management tool will track all of them and say, you're on step 13 of this one and step 14 of this one. We try to make it into one of those things where you don't think anymore, and you just do what it tells you to do.
Terry.
So if I have a niche that I'm looking at, for example, I have a recipe niche. I take that niche and follow the steps in Affiliate Classroom. Then if I wanted to have a niche on health food and another one on race cars, I can use the same system on all of the sites, is that right?
Onik.
Exactly.
Those 3 would be plugged in, so if today you wanted to work on the race car site, you go into the site, click that niche, and it will say, you're on step 15 of this project. Step 15 might be whatever it is, and then you can just do whatever it says to do that day.
The next day, you can work on the recipe site.
You might not want to work on the race car site for another week or year. But, when you do come back, you will know exactly where you were.
Terry.
Fantastic.
Who is your target market?
Onik.
Our target market is definitely the beginner or intermediate affiliate.
We are working for more advanced material for expert affiliates.
Since our USP is step-by-step instruction, I don't go after expert affiliates that much because they already know what they're doing.
Someone who doesn't know anything about affiliate marketing whatsoever, this is the place for that person.
Terry.
Okay.
So, what makes you special as opposed to listening to anyone else?
There is a ton of information out there about affiliate marketing.
Why should someone listen to you as opposed to one of the other experts?
Anik. One of the things is that there is an information overload. There are a lot of people that are very good, however, the reason that a lot of people take towards my program is because, once again, it's a step-by-step program. With most other people, you're purchasing an ebook or a guide. As great as they are, they don't provide you with tracking tools or management tools. Affiliate marketing is also changing every month. For example, earlier this month Google declared something that was going to be pretty hurtful for affiliates, talking about not having as many ads as you want for particular programs. That in turn created the need to create your own sites now and provide traffic to your own pages. Things like that happen on a monthly basis in internet marketing. So, you might have purchased a guide 3 or 4 years ago and now it's out of date already.
Terry.
So instead of having an ebook and following the steps through the ebook, your site is much more interactive.
Anik.
Far more interactive and updated with new content every month.
Terry.
How do you go about choosing a specific affiliate program to join and promote?
Anik.
That's a good question. How do we pick a niche? That's something that we always talk about in the affiliate classroom, because we actually do niche profiling every month. We profile about 10 niches every month for affiliates to work with. One of the things I look for in a niche is the demand. I find the demand for a particular niche using a tool like AdWord Analyzer, or I'll use Overture. Overture has a free search tool. You can type in the word and it will tell you how many searches were done on it in the past month.
Next thing I look for is competition.
For example, I know there's a huge demand for something like dating, but if you look into the competition, there is an incredible amount of competition. I have to weigh those two with each other, so when I'm looking into an affiliate program, I'm going to make sure there isn't too much competition, but enough searches to create demand.
Third thing is commission. That's what we're all in it for, the money.
So, I'm not going to go for a product or service that pays me 3% commission, unless they're going to pay me 3% on $5,000. If so, then I have to see how easy it is to sell this $5,000 product.
My typical commission, if it's a physical product, I want at least 10%.
But, if it's a digital product, I won't go for anything under 30%. Another thing that's unique about our system, that I drill into the affiliate classroom students, is upselling. I don't know why affiliates don't do it, but personally I made over $10,000 in 60 days with upselling, and I was online for about 1 or 2 hours a day.
I was promoting the program and just by upselling that program.
Terry.
How did you do that?
Anik. When I first used the program Traffic Equalizer, it worked like a charm for me. People started asking me questions about it, and I realized that people were buying Traffic Equalizer through my affiliate link so they could ask me questions. Something clicked in my head and I created a page about my experience with Traffic Equalizer. Then, I realized that people were going to that page, it was selling like crazy, and I was making a lot of money through this affiliate product. I also realized that after people bought the product, half aren't using it, and the other half try to use it for a couple of days and then give up.
I'm getting a swarm of questions as well. Someone emailed me and said, "I'll pay you if you'll do this for me. I bought this software, but I don't feel like learning how to use it. I'll pay you to put it up on my site." I said, "Okay, sure. Why not?" 2 days later, I get another person asking me the same thing. So, the market told me that they needed this service. So, I set up a $500 package that, for $500, I would set up the whole thing on your site for you. Web design was included, keyword selection, everything. When I first put it up, I didn't expect it to be that much of a hit, but then I realized that I was converting over 10% of the people who purchased it through the affiliate link. That was a 1-2-3 thing for me because I did so many sites. It was such easy money. You're looking at a college student who made $10,000 working an hour a day or something like that.
That was incredible.
Terry.
So it took you an hour to set up Traffic Equalizer on people's site.
Anik. It would take me 2 hours maximum.
Terry.
So you got paid $500 for 2 hours of work.
Anik.
Exactly.
Terry.
Beautiful.
Onik. At this point, I'm never an affiliate for a site unless I see an upsell there.
Whether it's a service upsell or anything.
Anything expensive, between $100 and $500.
That's another thing I look for when I'm looking for a niche.
The last thing I do is I email the merchant and I see how quickly he responds.
If I'm going to work to promote somebody, then he better treat me special and answer me quickly.
If you're going to take 3 or 4 days to answer a simple question, it's probably not a good product or service for me to promote.
Terry.
Can I just step back and ask, what is traffic equalizer?
Onik.
Sure.
That's one of the most popular questions I get.
What you basically do with traffic equalizer is feed it a list of keywords.
It takes those keywords and creates a directory page for you. It basically goes into a search engine, types in the keywords, and takes the first 20 results and puts them on your page for you.
It creates a directory page.
The thing is, it can create about 1,000 of them in 15 minutes.
Terry.
And this is a piece of software that is sitting on my site.
Onik.
Well, you can either have it on your computer, so it creates the pages on your computer and you can upload them, or, the way I prefer it, is to use their web version of the software. I just load it up on my site and it creates the pages on my server.
These pages are well keyword optimized. With TE, you're not going to go after a word like dog, you'll never get to number one with that.
TE works best with keywords that are 2 or 3 words long. Maybe they only get 100 or 200 searches each in a month, but the thing is, they probably have very little competition. So, what you do is you put about 1,000 or 1,500 of those and optimize your website to those.
Even if a keyword is getting 200 searches a month, now you have 1,500 of them and that can build up pretty quickly.
Terry,
you said before that you would look in a niche and find out how many clicks they had, like in Overture, and then see if that niche was something that would turn out to be profitable for you.
How does that relate to, for example, you said with traffic equalizer, you can have a keyword with 200 clicks, how is that related to the clicks you would look at in Overture?
Is it somewhat the same?
Would 200 clicks on Overture determine that it's a good niche to go after?
Onik.
No, definitely not.
If you have a niche with a main keyword that's only getting 200 searches a month, that's a horrible niche.
Stay away from it.
That's my take on it, at least.
I might have a website about dogs.
If you type in the word dog, you'll probably get millions of searches.
You'll know that it's a very high demanded niche.
If you go to a software search tracker and type in the word dog, it's going to pump out 10,000 or 20,000 keywords that are dog related.
If I have a website about dogs, you might have a keyword like poodle potty training.
Now we're getting into a keyword that's not going to have as many searches.
But, at the same time, it's still related.
Using TE, I might go after that keyword.
What you want to do to evaluate that niche is use the main keyword, like dog.
If it has a lot of searches, you have an in-demand niche.
But, if your main keyword itself only has a few hundred or even a few thousand searches, then you're looking at a very low-demand niche.
Terry.
Okay.
So the way that you determine, with TE, is if it even has a couple of hundred, it's seen as a couple of hundred within 1,000 pages, and combined will make 20,000 clicks.
Onik.
Sure.
Terry.
Okay.
Onik.
I just want to clarify to everyone that traffic equalizer is a small element.
I've been stamped with a traffic equalizer stamp, but in actuality, Affiliate Classroom has little to do with it.
I do use it, but just as a warning, TE has been getting a bad reputation lately.
It creates a lot of pages at the same time and search engines aren't going to like it.
So, if you do plan on using traffic equalizer, I still use it, and it still works really well, but I never put it on my main domain name. If I have a domain name doghelp.com, and that was my main site, and I'm following Affiliate Classroom's directions and I'm setting up this search engine friendly website, and I want to go after the keyword doghelp, then I will never add traffic equalizer to that site.
I will create a second domain name and put TE on there.
Then, I can filter the traffic on that domain name to my other one.
But, that's just to be safe.
If you're not careful with the way you use it, then you will get your site banned, so you have to be quite careful.
Terry.
Okay. Can you explain that? Why is it getting a bad reputation?
Onik. When it first came out, people were abusing it in the sense that you can create a site that is 30,000 to 50,000 pages in literally a day. If you let the software run on its own, it can create a site that is massively huge. They're all basically direct through pages. Technically, direct through pages have been around forever, they're fine and resourceful. But, the whole system and how it's created will get frowned upon by Google because they say that it can't be genuine content if it's created so quickly.
So, that's why it's been getting a bad reputation. You also have to understand that actual people and companies who do that the right way slash long way are going to put all of their resources together and go against the software.
Terry.
So what happens if I end up landing on one of the pages that Traffic Equalizer has generated? Am I going to see a directory?
Onik.
A typical form of the page is that you'll see promotions for their affiliate promotions on the top. If you click them, you'll probably go to a different domain name that someone will make money off of. If you scroll down a little bit, you'll see the almost the same thing that you'd see if you went to Google and typed in a keyword. You'd see 10 or 15 sites related to that keyword.
Terry.
How am I making money if somebody clicks on one of those sites?
Onik.
You're not going to make any money if somebody clicks on the directory site.
That's free traffic.
The way you monetize off of TE pages is that on the top you have a promotion for your own product that you make a commission off of when people click it. Also, the biggest moneymaker with Traffic Equalizer is Google AdSense.
Terry.
What's that?
Onik.
Google AdSense is a program that Google offers that allows you to place their ads on your pages. If anyone clicks the ad, you're paid per click.
Terry.
So it's a reverse of Google AdWords then, you're actually paid for somebody clicking on your link and not the other way around.
Onik.
Exactly. They're going to pay you a part of whatever the company pays them.
Terry.
That makes sense. If you just signed up with an affiliate business right now, can you walk us through the steps of how you would set things up?
Onik.
Sure.
First thing that I want to focus on is if I'm starting a business now in the affiliate sector, I'm going to focus on content.
Content is king, is what people say, and that's very true. Especially as search engines get more sophisticated, the more content that you have, the better you're going to get ranked. The steps that I would take, first of all, I have to find my niche.
I'm going to use the same exact process to find that niche as we discussed earlier. Just basically looking out for those different things. After I find my niche, I'm going to do more research on the affiliates in that niche and the different programs.
Terry.
Okay.
How do you do that?
Onik.
I usually go to Google and say I want to find affiliate programs in the dog industry. I type in dog plus affiliate and then I hit enter. What Google does is go into different websites that have the word dog and see if they also have the word affiliate on them. Then, it pumps out a big list. Then, I click on all of those links, which end up being different merchant programs that have affiliate programs.
Then, I see which are offering the most commission and see their products, etc.
I choose two or three in the beginning. At that point, it's time to think of an edge for myself.
I need to think about why someone would come to my dog website instead of all of the ones that already exist. So, my next step is to think about what I'm actually doing on my site.
The next thing I'm going to do before I start is think of an upsell.
Really, we're still in the planning process here.
Once I have those things done, I think of how I'm going to do my website.
The issue here that most people come into is, if you're building a large content website, it's not as easy as just knowing a little bit of HTML. At that point, you need a content management system, something that will automate it for you, and be search engine friendly at the same time.
So, it gets kind of tricky.
This is the area that we're trying to tackle next in Affiliate Classroom, because this is a very tricky area.
Currently, there are two solutions.
I like both of them, but I'm not crazy about both of them.
One of them is SEO-website-builder.com. It's by a pretty well-known marketer, Andy Williams, and he did an excellent job. It costs about $150, but once you have the software, you can build as many websites as you want.
It's also set up in a pretty step-by-step process that also automates it for you. All you really have to do is write the content, pop it into the software, and it pumps out websites for you. It's done pretty well, but as with any system, there are limitations. I know that everyone who tries it will find at least one thing that they wish they could do that they won't be able to do. But it's a perfect solution for anyone who's starting. The other one is called SiteBuildIt by Sitesell.com. It was created by Ken Evoy, and it's more famous, it was one of the first ones. I like that program, and at the same time, I have my reserves with it. I think that Ken is a great guy and he's always trying to improve the program. At the same time, when I used it, I thought it took too long to make a page. It does it really well, the page takes a long time but will serve the purpose for the long term. I just got a little frustrated with it, but I think they worked the kinks out. Those are two good scripts to help getting yourself into website building. The solution that we're working on is going to be a lot more user-friendly. I think it's going to be a lot quicker also. Both of these software focus a lot of keyword density, which means if you have a specific keyword, it sees how many times you use it on your particular page. As of today, search engines are slowly moving away from that because it's easy to know how many times you typed in a keyword, so people are misusing that. The system that we're building for Affiliate Classroom will be a lot more simplified. We're going to focus more on what Google is going after because all of the search engines are following Google. I'm still talking to the developer. We developed the initial form of the script, and I'm going to test it out personally on some of my own sites. Then, we'll talk about it more. I'm hoping to have that solution, though, because I know the biggest probably for affiliates has been how to develop a site. Terry. Speaking of affiliates, you have contacts with hundreds and maybe even thousands of affiliates. Can you share with us some successful affiliate stories? Anik. Sure. Rosalind Gardner is a huge advocate of using Google AdWords to drive traffic to sites. She has a huge share of the dating market. When I heard about that, I thought that, since she can do it, I can do it. I miserably failed. I could not handle that market because it just wasn't for me. I know that she does really well. I have a personal success story that you've probably seen over and over on the internet because it was so amazing. When I marketed Traffic Equalizer and had the upsell. I also have a personal website in the debt industry. I also have an affiliate website in education guides. There are exams such as MCATs and GMATs here in the States. I'm not sure if they're offered internationally. Terry. What are they? Anik. They are professional exams. Once you graduate college and you want to get your graduate degree, depending on the degree, you take an exam. Terry. Oh, okay. Anik. I have one website where I promote for people who want to get their MBA and things that can help them get ready for that. That site does pretty well. I've been in touch with Chris Carpenter before, and I know that he is famous for Google Cash. He goes out and finds an affiliate program, finds it, pumps in a Google ad for it, and directs traffic directly to the merchant. That's it, he doesn't even have a website. That's how he did it for so many years, and he made a lot of money. Now, Google changed its system, it's still working, you can still use it, and there are a lot of solutions coming out in the near future for people who don't want to create their own landing pages. There are really successful affiliate marketers all around us. I read something the other day that was very interesting. I read a newsletter that said someone in London officially has an affiliate business that's evaluated to be worth $960 million. Terry. Really? Anik. I'm still reading it and checking it out, but it said that this guy started in 1996, and it's basically just a website where you compare credit cards and other types of debt and loan types of things. What they've done is set up a place where you just compare different types of services in the financial services. And just a few months back, it was evaluated at over $900 million by a London evaluation company. Terry. Wow. Do you have the website address for that? Anik. No, I don't have it on me because I just started reading it and then I had to run out. What I'll do is, once I read it again, I'll email it over to you. But, what they were basically saying is that these credit card companies pay very well. They don't pay for a sale, they pay for a lead. So, someone just has to apply for you to get paid. You could get paid anywhere between $8 and $30 per application. So, what these guys were doing is, say they were comparing 10 credit cards, someone might apply to 4 or 5 of them. There's a good way to make money there. If they've been around since 1996, they're probably getting a whole boatload of traffic from search engines. To be honest, I have a website in that industry, and it does pretty well, but nowhere near their numbers. I'm going to read more about it and send the article over to you. I thought it was very interesting.
Terry.
Yeah, sounds like a good business model to follow. So, in your opinion, between your successes and your not-so-successful examples, what's the big difference that separates the two?
Anik.
One of the things that I realized was that I tried to set up sites in areas that were low demand, or there was too much competition. I learned this next thing the hard way. I tried to set up sites in areas where there is huge demand, but little competition. That's something that people need to be careful about. I got excited and thought I was a genius. I spent a lot of money and then realized why there was no competition. The niche doesn't buy. I created my very first website, which was my own product on a website called bettergpa.com. It's a great book. People who read it always tell me that it's a great book. The problem is targeting college students. College students, now that I understand marketing, could care less about their grades because they want to spend money on partying and beer. So, I'm trying to convince a college student to give me his money so I can show him how to get better grades. That's an example of a niche that you don't want to go to. My book actually sells, but I had to do a lot of work to get it to sell. It's my baby, it's my first website ever, so I want it to sell. But, if I were going to start something like that today, it would be shut down within a month. So, one thing to watch out for is finding a niche with high demand and no competition. Don't get too excited if you find one. There is probably a very good reason that it's like that. Another reason I found in a few of my flop projects like my dating site was a complete lack of interest in the topic. I started a mommy site for babies with baby care and stuff like that. For anybody who loves babies or is actually a mom, it's a great niche to be in. New moms spend money, and there are a lot of websites about that topic. Most of the people who run those websites are usually stay-at-home moms, and nice people for the most part. It's a nice niche to work in and it's easy to trade links and stuff like that. I realized that I didn't care at all about writing content for that site. With the dating site, it didn't last because I couldn't think of a good, unique edge for my site. I couldn't think of why people should visit my site instead of others like Rosalind's. Another thing that I noticed, which isn't really one of my problems, but I've had affiliates ask me this question, is that they're building sites on commissions that give 4 or 5% on a $40 or $50 product, which is nothing. You can't even pay for advertising with that because that's not enough money. The last and final one is that there is no upsell opportunity in some markets. In some markets, it's just too hard to sell an expensive product. Although you can create a site and it can be profitable, I'm addicted to the upsell thing right now because you can easily triple or quadruple your profits just by having one upsell. So, I try to stay away from niches that don't have a good upsell.
Terry.
So you look for something that you're interested in that also has an upsell opportunity.
Anik.
Yeah.
I don't look for a dying interest because if I were doing that, I wouldn't have many niches. But yeah, I look for something with some kind of interest. Being a 21-year-old college guy, there is very little interest in baby care, but there is some interest in credit cards and whatnot. When I'm reading articles, writing articles, getting information, and getting content on credit cards, I actually learn a lot. I kind of enjoy that market a little bit because I am a finance major and I learn about it all the time. So, look for some connection. I have some people who write to me that say, I don't know anything about this niche. I ask them, okay, you don't know anything about this niche, but are you an expert marketer? They say, no, this is my first site. Then I say, that's the wrong niche to go after then. You can go after a site that you know nothing about, but not until you know exactly what you're doing. I'm getting to that point now where I get into niches that I know nothing about, but I'm at a stage now where I can pay writers and people who know about that niche to write stuff for me so I don't have to get personally involved in that niche. So, the first few sites that you have starting your career, make sure they're about something that interests you.
Terry.
So you basically can go into a niche and develop quality content by hiring qualified writers, and you don't have to know anything about it if you don't want to.
Anik.
Yeah.
What I'm slowly moving into for the summertime is that once my scripts for the website building are done, I'm going to be hiring some help. The whole idea is going to be that I outsource to a writer, and once I get the information, you plug it into the site by using my script.
That's it. I don't even want to know about it.
I might check in on it every once in a while to make sure that it's doing okay. I have someone that I use for my search engine optimization who is great. When I create a project, I try to create a team so I have someone who writes, someone who does the web design, someone who does the search engine optimization, and they all work together while I sit and watch TV.
Terry.
That sounds good.
If you were coming online now in the starting phase, would you start off promoting affiliate programs or would you start off with your own products?
Anik.
It's funny, but what helped me this year break into my six figures is that I created a combination of both of them. Affiliate programs can be promoted on their own and can do very well, but you need to give them a lot of time. People who first start out on the internet need to see something quick or they're not going to get latched into it and think that it's fake.
They need to see something decent.
What I found works for the affiliates that I train and that are successful is to do a combination of both. Set up an affiliate website where you draw traffic. Set up a $30 or $40 affiliate product. Then also create your own upsell. So, you're still creating your own product, but the upsell can be a service, it doesn't have to be a product. One of my recent clients that I helped set up with had a resume writing ebook.
That's a pretty hot niche too, it's pretty competitive, but it exists.
What we did for him is, he sells his $30 ebook, and for $200, he'll write your resume for you.
It's doing very well.
The people who buy the ebook will get an email that asks, "Do you really want to write that resume yourself?" Most of the people don't, and give him the $200 to do it for them.
Terry.
Excellent.
Anik.
So he didn't have to create a product, he does a service that he likes doing anyway. In his case, he created his own ebook, but someone who wants to do that can easily have an affiliate program with another ebook and then offer to write a resume for the people who he sells that ebook to.
Terry.
Right, okay.
So, is there a relationship between the price that the people pay and the upsell price? This guy sells his ebook for $30, and the upsell is $200.
Would it be unreasonable to think that someone would be a $30 ebook and then a $600 service?
Anik.
Actually, I learned a lot of this from Frank Kern.
I like to call him the king of upselling.
That's how he builds most of his businesses, by upselling expensive products. What I found is that you have to sell your customer over and over so they gain your trust. So I set up a little system, I realized that I first have to sell them on giving me their email. So, they opt in and they've given me the right to contact them. Then, I follow up with them and I get them to buy something between $30 and $50. At that point, the window is now open to move in to sell a product between $100 and $500. That's from experience, I see that in some niches, you can move into the $1,000 kill right away. That's really rare, however. What most marketers do is email, then $30 to $50 guide, then some kind of $500 thing, then the $2,000 or $3,000 upsell. I'll give you a live example. People would do this in internet marketing all the time. You sign up for an ezine, then they sell you the $30 ebook, then they sell you a $500 physical package course, then every year they might have one or two live seminars or conferences that you fly to and stay, which cost anywhere between $1,000 to $2,000. That's the process they set up.
Terry.
Excellent. You mentioned there that when you market, you use email. Have you found that with all of the spam filters in place, that it's still possible to build an affiliate business using email?
Anik.
Most definitely.
I'll tell you what it is, email effectiveness has definitely decreased, I won't argue that. I'll give you a live example because I have been using solo ads like crazy the last couple of weeks to promote affiliate classroom.
Almost 85% of them have been profitable.
Before, I would invest $100 and I'd get $500 or $600 back. That was when most of the emails were being delivered and when ezines weren't a dime a dozen. Now, if I invest $100, I get $200 or $250 back. But, nevertheless, it was profitable.
Terry. You're still in the positive.
Onik.
Yeah, you're still making money.
So, it's decreased, but it's not completely gone. I think both of us are examples because we have a huge list of questions for this interview and they were generated by sending out quick messages to our lists. So, people are getting the messages and are still responding.
How you treat your list is number one.
I don't like promoting products too much to my list because I think they get annoyed. I like giving my list information and when I give them a recommendation, they know that I'm serious about it.
They know that it has to be something that's seriously good because I wouldn't tell them otherwise.
So, I'm going to get a huge response rate.
Terry. How often would you mail an offer, as opposed to sending content, which is building your reputation with the person? Would you do it once or twice a month?
Onik.
It depends.
I think I better clarify what I mean by an offer.
I mean a mailing just to get them to buy something.
Most of my content will always have an affiliate link somewhere in the article. This isn't to really try to sell something to them, it's just to give them the option. Recently, I wrote an article about writing for articles and submitting them to directories. A lot of that stuff I learned was from ezineannouncer.com. So, I'll provide that reference link at the end. I might do that once or twice a week, depending on how much content I write that week. But, an actual promotion piece that is strictly to get them to buy it, maybe once or twice a month.
Terry.
So how important is article writing for you?
It sounds like you write a lot of articles.
Onik.
Yes.
I was very lazy when I started off in internet marketing. But, as I've grown, I realized that content writing is where it's at on the internet. So, I am becoming more and more active in it, and it's been really good for affiliate classroom. I'm releasing a case study in February where I'm going to reveal, by just submitting 5 or 6 articles to directories, how many members I was able to attract. This way, people can see how profitable it was. That way I'm allowing my own affiliate in affiliate classroom to go out and repeat the same process themselves.
Terry.
Beautiful.
Onik.
So I do write a lot of articles. My goal is to submit one article a day, but I haven't been very good about that.
It's tough, writing an article isn't always easy.
I have a lot of stuff that I can write about, but getting my thoughts together, it usually takes half hour or 45 minutes to pump out something that I would even consider submitting. Then, even with all of the submission tools, it will still take me an hour or an hour and a half to really submit one.
Terry.
That's a good point there.
What do you use to submit your articles?
Once you have one written, what do you do next?
Onik.
It really depends on your niche. In the internet marketing niche, there's a website called submityourarticle.com. It's a membership site where you pay $37 a month, but what's really neat about it is that you just put your article up, hit submit, and I don't know how many places he submits it to, but it's something like thousands of publishers and hundreds of websites. That system has proven to me to be the best so far. But, he only tailors to the internet marketing crowds, so he only takes the articles about how to make money or how to start a business.
Then, there's ezineannouncer.com, by Jason Potash.
His product is really good too because he has all different kinds of niches in there. I don't know how he came up with that product, it must have taken him so long.
It's an excellent product.
I'm just familiarizing myself with it now, but I highly recommend it from what I've seen so far.
Terry.
The next thing is, as far as being an affiliate, how realistic is it to make a 6-figure income just promoting affiliate programs?
Onik.
It is realistic, but it takes time. If you want to make 6 figures as an affiliate, become a master of search engine optimization.
My personal opinion is that you cannot make 6 figures if you don't know search engine optimization. I know someone out there doing Google AdWords might say, that's not true. But, here's my issue with Google AdWords.
I agree that if I spent the next 3 months in a dungeon testing different niches and putting up different ads, that I could probably get it to a point where I was making six figures, but all Google has to do is make one tiny little change, and there goes my entire income. So, if you learn the basics of search engine optimization, and you do it the right way, there's a lot less chance of that happening. A lot of people will come back to me and argue the same thing and say, "What if someone makes a search engine change?" I've been doing this for 2 years and I've been watching search engines very closely. One of my best buddies online is one of the top 30 search engine optimizers in the world. So, I'll tell you that if you do the basics of Google and create real content, go after a real linking strategy, and just do a genuine job, they won't change your system to really block you. Even if they make changes, if you know SEO, it's so quick to change that page. So, bottom line, if you want to make six figures as an affiliate, you have to know search engine optimization.
Terry.
Okay.
What about time?
You said it's a time-related function. What kind of time frame would we be looking at?
Onik.
If you put up a brand new site today and you wanted to be number one for a keyword on search engines, you're looking at 6 months.
Let's say I want to go after the keyword dog health.
It's probably a pretty competitive keyword, so I might need a website that has 100 or 200 pages of content. I set that up with my linking strategy, and for the next 6 months, I keep getting links and keep doing the search engine optimization. 6 months from now, when Google does all its updates, I might find myself on the first page. At that point, I'll be seeing a lot of Google traffic. So, my strategy is that for those 6 months, spend 1 month actively on one website. You can probably take a month or two off while it's doing all of the updates and waiting to get indexed. Then, you start working on your second one. So, in 6 months, if you're doing it full-time, you can pump out really good affiliate websites in competitive niches. Then, you could find yourself making $10,000 or more a month.
Terry. That sounds promising.
Onik.
It sounds rosy, but it's not easy stuff. If you're willing to add your own upsells, I think that it's twice as easy at that point.
Terry.
Because you're adding added value as well.
Onik.
Yeah.
You might take the average value of one customer from $10 to $100. That's why I'm such an advocate of it because, as an affiliate, if you don't want to work as hard, then just add your own upsells.
Terry.
Excellent. You also mentioned, in the affiliate site that you're building is to use some linking strategies. What do you use as a linking strategy?
Onik.
Linking is the number one thing for search engine optimization.
Linking is great itself because it brings a lot of traffic. If nothing else, everybody should be doing linking. Say I recruit 3,000 incoming links. Let's say each link sends me one guy a day.
These sites, if they're getting a few hundred visitors or 1,000 visitors, you can get at least one guy off of them.
If you can get 3,000 to give you one guy a day, that's 3,000 people a day.
Terry.
How do you do that?
How do you get these links?
Onik.
There's no trick to it.
You find the websites first.
I do that by going into Google, typing in my niche, and they'll of course give me a bunch of sites. From that, I create a file and I just email them and say, "I've seen your site and I like it. I have a website with a related niche and I thought maybe you would consider exchanging links with me."
Terry. What do you do with their link then?
Onik.
What you usually do is create a link directory page on your own site.
So, if their site is about dog potty training, then I might have a directory link that says potty training.
If somebody clicks it, then that site will be there.
If you email 100 people, maybe you'll get 5 or 8. It's an ugly business, it's all about numbers when you're in the linking business.
Terry.
So it's a sales job all on its own.
Onik.
Exactly.
You're always selling someone on something.
Terry.
That's true.
Back on the affiliate side of things, I just recently read some statistics that suggested that only 5% of affiliates are making any real money.
Why do you think that is?
Onik.
First of all, that's good news. I think that number has gone up. I think it used to be a lot lower than that.
I think one reason is that people are not patient and affiliate marketing requires patience.
It's so easy to sign up as an affiliate.
We have millions of affiliate marketers, but they're not really affiliate marketers, they just signed up for one affiliate program.
Terry. They're just sign-up junkies.
Onik.
Exactly.
You can't have that in the merchant industry because you have to create your own product. That's another psychological benefit of having your own upsell. Now you're serious because you have your own product or service.
It's not just that you sign up and have a good-looking link and then you're done, it's that you've actually spent time on it, so you're not going to let it go so quickly.
So, I think the biggest issue is that affiliate marketing isn't easy and people are lost at what to do, but I think that a lot of people who call themselves affiliate marketers aren't really affiliate marketers.
Terry.
So that kind of brings the percentage up or down depending on how you're looking at it.
Onik.
Yeah, exactly.
The biggest issue is that affiliate marketing requires patience and work, you have to do a lot of work.
What a lot of people will do is put in a few weeks of work, make a little money and then think it's not worth it and quit.
What they don't realize is they're right there.
If they just kept going and did a few more weeks of the same work, then they would set themselves up with a long-term income.
They just gave up too soon.
Terry.
They're right at the edge and just didn't quite jump off.
Onik.
Exactly.
They stopped just a little bit too soon.
Terry.
So how many affiliate programs should somebody be promoting at the same time?
Onik.
This is a huge question with massive amounts of debate, and I can already tell that I'm going to get emails from people saying, that's not true.
I will follow one thing that I learned from Ken Envoy, on a particular site, if you're making a product recommendation, always recommend about two or three different products.
Terry.
In the same line of business?
Onik.
Right.
So, if I have a vitamin site and someone comes to me wanting vitamin D, I'm not going to say, buy from this company.
I'm going to say, here's a review on three of them.
Here are the pros and cons of all three.
The one I personally recommend is number one, but it's up to you.
Terry. So you actually have three affiliate programs for exactly the same product.
Onik.
Exactly.
Now, the benefit in this is that people love to make choices and love to know that they're in control.
Your conversions will shoot through the roof when people know that they're in control.
When they go to that merchant site, they chose to go to that site.
It's a massive psychological difference between the thought that they were forced to go to that site because there was no other link and that they had research on a few different products and they chose to go to that specific one because that's the better product.
They're already going in with the buying frame of mind.
Terry.
Do the majority of them go through your recommendation anyway?
Onik.
Yes.
That's the best part, most of them will go through your recommendation.
Terry.
Do you have different price classes within the three that you're recommending or are they all pretty much the same?
Onik.
Don't make them wildly different.
Or, as a strategy to sell, make the one that you're trying to push the cheaper one.
Terry.
The cheaper one?
Onik.
Depending on your product.
If you're in the vitamin world, you can argue for a more expensive vitamin and say, this is the better vitamin because it costs more, kind of thing.
You might make more money.
But, if you're selling someone something that's trivial, they might choose to go to the cheaper one because they can save money.
I would say to stay around the same price range.
Make it more of a debate about quality and stuff like that rather than the price.
Some of the sites that do the best online are sites like Newegg.com, they're just genius ideas.
When you go to the site, you can type in MP3 player, and it's going to come up with a list of all the models that you can choose from.
Then, you choose your model, and all it's going to do is that it has 30 different internet stores that are offering the MP3 player and it just tells you all of the prices.
It will also tell you which has free shipping, which has a sale or special discount, and how many days it will take to ship to you for a list of 30 of them.
It ranks them in price, quality, or whatever you want to rank them in.
Those sites make the most money because, once I click on it, I'm going to make my decision right there.
But, I'll go back to that site every single time because they give me everything I need in one shot.
So, that's where that whole idea came from. You can see it working live. These corporate companies are doing this and it's working out very well for them.
Terry. Using the concept of your choice.
Anik.
Yeah.
I learned it from Ken Envoy, but I think that concept has been around a while.
Terry.
So, if I was looking at an affiliate program to promote, is it better to go after high-priced items or low-priced items?
Anik.
It really depends on the niche. My personal preference is to go after both.
I've been drilling that the whole time, sell the low price first and the high price second.
It really depends on your niche, and it depends on how much money that niche is willing to spend.
I've heard from people that in the golfing niche, it's easier to sell someone an expensive product than it is to sell them a cheap product.
Terry.
Because of perceived quality, maybe.
Anik.
Yeah, because of perceived quality, and because of the clientele that you're working with.
Golfers are, for the most part, pretty classy.
It's a huge hobby. Golf people buy a lot of stuff.
They also golf with their buddies.
They don't want to get the cheap things.
I want to pull out a $2,000 putter because it's better than the one my buddy plays with. Even though I don't know how to golf at all, I still want to use the more expensive one.
I've learned that in some of the classy niches, it's easier to sell someone something that's expensive.
I think that someone has to be careful before they say something like that.
You need to test it for your own niche.
I always say to offer both, so if they don't want to buy the expensive one, they'll buy the cheap one.
Terry.
Yeah, back to your choice formula.
So, are there any promotional techniques that are different if you're promoting a high-priced product as opposed to a low-priced product?
Anik.
Yes.
I think that if you're going to promote a high-priced product, it's a little more of a process.
There needs to be more trust developed.
It's different.
For example, if I set up a corporate site to sell someone golf clubs, then someone can come to my site and choose between my 10 different golf clubs, order, then leave. That's very different than if I am selling a real estate training package, where you can buy $40 ebooks on how to do real estate, or you can buy my $3,000 seminar, or as an affiliate, I want you to come to someone else's $3,000 seminar. At that point, I have to somehow convince this guy why he should go to a $3,000 seminar instead of buying a $40 ebook.
So, that's when we kick into the whole process that we mentioned.
I'll give him an ezine first after he gives me his email. Then, I'll deliver him some free informational ebooks that also do a very fine-tuned job of promoting the seminar.
So, they're informational, but they have the little plugs set up throughout them.
Then, I might try to say, how about you see how my last seminar was?
I'll sell you the taped version of the seminar for $300.
Then, after he buys the taped seminar, you are gaining trust because you are giving him great customer service.
Maybe when you picked up his email you also got his phone number, so maybe you can drop him a phone call and see if he has any questions that you can answer.
It's really a game of trust building.
After all of that is when you can plug him to try to buy a ticket to go to the seminar.
You want to show him that you provide great service and that the $40 ebook guy wouldn't do that.
So, selling an expensive product is more of a process.
When I sold my $500 service, the first thing I did was sell them the $150 software, then I sold them the $500 service.
Terry.
And that was in a very short period of time, wasn't it?
Anik.
I did it within 2 days of selling them the $150 software.
Actually, something that I learned from one of the biggest marketers I've ever met, Michael Masterson, was a very unique story that I share with people also. He was in an airport with one of his buddies one day, and they walked into one of the very expensive briefcase stores.
Michael Masterson has an addiction to briefcases. He always likes to have the newest and nicest one on him.
His buddy had a 10-year-old one that was ripping apart.
So, they walk into this briefcase store, and there is only one sales guy there.
He says that him and his buddy split up and went into different directions.
The question to us was, who should that salesman approach?
The guy who already has one of the latest models?
Or the guy who has a 10-year-old one?
On a guy feeling, I would have approached the guy who has the crappy old briefcase because he needs a new one.
I found out, however, that that's the wrong answer.
The salesman actually approached Michael first, and was actually able to sell him a brand new briefcase, when the other guy walked out and didn't buy a thing. The reason for it is this: the best time to sell someone something is when he just bought something. The psychology behind it is because it's fresh in their mind and they're pumped up about it.
With that example, the guy who has a crappy briefcase doesn't care about his briefcase.
Michael definitely has a thing for briefcases. All the salesman has to do is say that his is outdated already and there are new ones, and he has already hooked Michael.
So, that's a great point.
If you're going to try to upsell someone, try to do it within a few days of when they bought their original thing.
Terry.
So how do you do that? They buy the original $30 ebook.
Do you send them an email right away that says, "Thanks for buying the ebook? Here's something else you should look at," or something like that?
Onik.
You contact them right away definitely to say thank you.
Then, it really depends on the product and on the niche, but I waited 2 days to purchase the service because I wanted them to have 2 days to fumble around with it. I wanted to get them right when they were frustrated and realized that they don't get it.
Then, they get an email that asks, "Do you want me to do this for you?" And for them it's like a godsend.
They're like, "Yes.
Thank you. I don't want to do this anymore."
In the case of the resume writing, it's exactly the same thing.
Wait 2 days.
They're going to read the book, try to write one on their own, get confused, not know what they're doing, and then they're going to get an email that says, "I'll do it for you." However, in the case of a real estate seminar, it might take more than one contact.
You might have to wait 2 days and say, "This is interesting. Check it out."
That's a really light sell.
Then, maybe a week later you send them another email and say, "Maybe you should check this out."
Maybe 2 weeks later, you try to really sell them and say, "I'll give you $200 off."
It really depends.
The things that matter are how expensive it is and how much trust you need to develop before you can try to sell it. But, always follow up within a couple of days with at least a hint so you kind of whet their appetite about it.
Terry.
On the practical side of things, how do you transfer people from being a prospect to being a customer? You have a list of people who are interested in golf, and first of all, they're in your ezine. But then, someone buys a $2,000 golf club from your online store. Now, that person has transferred from being a prospect to being a customer. So, you're going to follow up different with him because you're going to try to sell him a course on learning how to golf better, for example.
Are you still going to leave him as a prospect in your ezine? Or are you going to take him out of your ezine and put him into your customer base?
Onik. I leave him in both. I have my free ezine where the free promotions go out to everyone. Then, I have my second ezine that's set up so whenever someone buys something, he or she is automatically put onto that list.
Terry.
That's all done with autoresponders?
Onik.
Yes.
That's more of a merchant thing.
That wouldn't really apply to affiliates. The problem with affiliates is that, for example, ClickBank will tell you the email addresses of the people who bought through your link, so it's easy to start following up. But, most affiliate programs, especially the ones in niches that are selling physical products, the merchants are smart and don't give you any contact information about that person. So, you have to get a little bit slick in the sense that you have to give them special deals. Tell them, "If you buy this, email me your ID number, and I'll send you a free something, or, I'll mail you $50 back." If you sold a really expensive product and your commission was $200, maybe I'll send them $50.
That gives them a lot of motivation to come back and let me know that they bought it.
In that case, when they let me know, I'll try to sell them more stuff. So, in some cases, as a merchant, just in case people are interested, I have a couple of sites where they go into a 7-day series. If by the end of the 7th day they haven't bought anything, I might give them a $10 discount to try to convince them to buy. What happens if someone has bought something in those 7 days? I don't want him or her to get that email. They're going to get upset if they realize that they bought it for regular price. So, in those cases, I have the system set up to take them out of the ezine and put them into a different ezine.
Terry. Is that an automated system?
Onik.
Yeah, that's an automated system.
But, once again, that's for merchants, not affiliates.
Terry.
Sure.
What do you use as an automated system?
Onik. It's a program called Ultimate Affiliate Manager.
Terry. Same as me.
Anik.
I love that system.
I love Stephen Covey overall, he's a great guy.
Terry.
He's very service-oriented.
Anik.
He's 10 times better than me.
To me that sucks because I try to be the best, but I can't outdo that guy.
I don't know how he does it.
Terry.
I think he's away 24 hours a day.
He answers my emails within an hour.
Anik.
Exactly.
What I love about him is that he's so eager to help.
I'll ask him how to do something, and the email response back to me will say, I already did it.
I logged into your system and fixed it.
Don't worry about it anymore.
Terry.
He's fantastic.
Anik.
So if anyone's looking for an affiliate program, that's one for you.
Terry.
Exactly.
You have recommendations from both of us.
Anik.
Right.
Terry.
Back on the affiliate side of things, if you had to pick one most important thing that an affiliate marketer has to do to be successful, what would that be?
Anik.
Search engine optimization.
Terry.
Okay, what's the second?
Anik.
Yeah, because we already talking about that.
This is going to sound really corny and nobody's going to like this, but patience.
Most aren't patient, they just want money now.
If you were to ask me what number three was, it would be to have money to spend in advertising.
My business has blown up since I've bought advertising.
Terry.
Where do you go to find good places to advertise?
Anik.
It all depends on your niche.
I love Ezine ads, I'm a huge believer of buying solo ads and classified ads and stuff like that as well.
I like pay-per-click, but pay-per-click is tricky.
Before you go into that, I really recommend that you read up on it.
If you're an affiliate classroom member, before you start your pay-per-click campaign, you have to read a 10-page step guide that really walks you through it before you start.
Buying traffic from places such as solo ads, Ezines, buying links, banners on websites, the way you do that is, if your niche was golfing, you type golfing into Google and see the first few sites that come up.
You look for a link on them that says advertising, and you see their rates, see how much they charge for a banner or for a link.
The best thing that I love is that some of them have testimonials from different advertisers.
You can click on their link and go to their site.
I shoot the advertiser an email and ask how the advertisement on this particular site worked out.
I ask them if they're happy and if they're still using them.
Most of the time, even if you're considered their competition, they're pretty genuine and will get back to you and tell you the truth.
It's a good way to test the waters before you go out and buy a $100 banner.
Terry.
So, if you're doing a solo ad, how do you test your solo ads to make sure that the ad is pulling the way that you want it to?
Anik.
Before you actually buy it?
Terry.
Yeah, if you can actually test it before you buy it and during the process as well.
Anik.
There are two ways.
One way that I do is to check up on the references of the people who bought it before.
The second way to do it is, most Ezines who sell solo ads will also sell a classified ad, which is a top sponsored ad.
So, if I'm really shady about it and there's a really big price difference between the solo ad and the classified ad, I might buy the classified ad first, or the top sponsored ad, because it's cheaper so there's more money at risk.
If it produces results, then it's hands down guaranteed that the solo ad will produce results.
Terry.
How do you test the actual copy in your ad?
Anik.
This is the one thing that has been a bit confusing because there are so many elements in the solo ad.
First, how many people read it?
Second, how many people click it?
Third, how many people buy it in the end?
So one thing that I've noticed if you're doing an ad, I have some tips.
The headline, or the subject line that the merchant sends out is critical.
That's what's going to get people to open the email.
I like to use short, catchy headlines and I like to put numbers in them. For example, when I promote Affiliate Classroom, if I was promoting in Rim Digest, my headline will say something like, 10 new Rim Digest students wanted.
Limited offer. That's pretty much in their face making them want to open it up. As opposed to something like, learn how to make money online. How many times have you seen that?
So, the subject is the main thing. Your actual ad. I used to believe that a long story type of ad worked better, but I tested it and actually a short one works a lot better.
You just want them to click the link, and you want the page to do the selling. You don't want to do the selling on the actual ad.
My ads are usually 5 or 6 paragraphs now. They're kind of a story, they're not really a hard sell. They're more like, if you want to learn how I did this, 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 and this, you should click. Or, if you were in the golf niche, you could say, learn how a guy named Pete improved his putting average by XYZ by using this new, revolutionary putter.
Read the whole story here. I know that golf people will click that link.
In the end, testing it is really hard, especially as an affiliate.
So, the only element that you have to test it is how much money you made. Then, you can use an ad tracker to see how many clicks you got.
But merchants won't let you put stuff on their pages.
A lot of merchants might tell you what your conversion rate is on the site.
My affiliate program, if you send me 100 clicks and you get 4 sales, it will tell you that you're converting at 4%.
So, that's how you can track different forms of ads.
Terry, once you've got an ad that you tested in an e-zine that's working well for you, do you run a campaign of solo ads in the e-zine then? Or do you just leave it at one and move on to the next e-zine?
Anik,
I'm still playing at that, so I don't think I'm a big source to be talking about it.
My personal experience shows that you wait a few weeks and do it again and you'll have pretty much the same results.
Actually, you might slowly see an increase in results. It's a known fact in marketing that someone needs to see something 7 or 8 times before they buy it.
Terry,
are you running the exact same ad?
Anik,
no.
I may tweak it a little bit.
I'll be honest with you, I haven't seen a difference. I've tried running the same ad also, and the numbers stay the same.
I usually tweak it just a little bit for testing purposes.
Terry,
the next thing that works into the email talk, if you read any of a guru's information, he or she will say that having your own opt-in list is the most important thing that you have.
As an affiliate, how can you build an opt-in list?
Anik,
if you have your own website, if you use the system that I'm talking about, you have to have some form of website. An opt-in is pretty simple. You need an autoresponder service, and then choose a topic to focus your e-zine on. We can go back to the golfing example. You can have an e-zine that goes out once a week that gives golfing tips. From the technical side of it, it's very easy. It's just getting an autoresponder series, which costs anywhere between $5 and $20 a month, depending on what service you get. You just put a code on your page and it creates an opt-in box. Then, you just make a little promotional piece that says why someone should join your email list. At that point, it's your responsibility to handle the week-to-week content.
Terry,
so then everything runs on autopilot except you writing a content piece once a week.
Anik,
yeah, exactly.
Some people who don't want to do a week-to-week e-zine don't want an autoresponder.
I disagree.
I think, what you do at that point is, sit down for a week, create 5 messages or 20 or 30 messages, and it's more of a course instead of a newsletter. You have them opt in for free, and what you've done is you've already put them into the autoresponder. For the next few weeks or months, they'll keep getting your emails, and you're not doing anything. Once they're done with your 20 or 30 week course, or even 5 or 10 week course, then they're done. They'll still stay a member of your newsletter, so if one day you have a great product that you want to send, you can just send an email to this sitting base of customers. So, you don't have to do week-to-week publishing.
Just write a few messages. You'll see some form of conversion and at least you're writing a list.
Terry,
right.
That's excellent.
What's a good routine for an affiliate to follow on a daily basis?
What should they be focusing on?
Anik,
that's a tough question to answer primarily because everyone is so different and the niches are different. Lately, I've been becoming a huge advocate of content.
So, if you're an affiliate, I think you should focus on recruiting content.
That doesn't mean that you have to write it. There are a lot of article directories online.
For example, you can go to goarticles.com and you can pick up articles on all sorts of niches.
you can also go to ezinearticles.com. If you don't want to write your own thing, you can go out and get an article from them and add it to your site. The only thing they require is that you have to mention who wrote it and put their resource box in the article.
It's still content and it's still going to help you with search engine optimization.
You can still put your own banners and ads around the article. You just have to throw in the author's name and website at the bottom of the article. I think on a daily routine, you need to be adding content to your site.
Another thing that I'm a huge advocate for right now is you need to be recruiting incoming link partners. People have told me that even better than search engine optimization is the traffic that you get from the links.
One of my friends was telling me that his traffic from his links is 5 times as much as his traffic from search engine optimization.
So, that's enough reason. That's long-term traffic. Once you recruit a link, it's there. You can go on a vacation for a month and you'll still be getting traffic from it.
Terry, is it a link for a lot of traffic or is it a link that brings you a lot of quality traffic?
Onik, it's quality traffic because I'm only going to ask for links of people who are in my niche.
So, if I have a golfing website, I'm not going to go to a dog website and ask for a link back.
First of all, that's a waste.
The person that I ask would probably say, "What are you, crazy? Your link has nothing to do with me."
Second of all, search engines are going to say, "What the heck is this? This makes no sense to us."
And there goes your ranking.
Third of all, it's a waste of time.
I'm only focusing on websites related to my niche, so it's very targeted and quality traffic.
Terry, are you going to get links with direct competitors or people who are in your niche but not directly competing with you?
Onik, most of the time, competitors won't link with you. If you're looking at a corporate business, you might not get a link back from golf.com because that is a corporate site and they aren't doing search engine optimization because they don't need to do it.
They have enough traffic going to them.
But, another guy like you, let's say you sell putters, but he sells drivers. You're not in competition.
But, if someone who is buying a putter will probably want to buy a driver, you're not directly competing.
Even if you are, and you cross-link some of the products, you still might get a link from them.
You probably won't get links from direct competition, though.
Terry, do you have a list of what the hot markets are right now?
Onik, yeah, I do. There are a bunch of hot markets. Right now, I've seen that new moms buy a lot. That's a pretty good niche. Gardening has always been a pretty good niche.
Dating. I know so many people who are doing well in the dating industry, I just couldn't do it. I'm still going to keep it as a hot niche because I know a lot of people who are making good money at it.
Anything finance related, credit cards, loans.
Those niches are very competitive and you're also competing against multi-million dollar industries.
Another reason that I think it's a good niche is because it pays out so well. Real estate is an excellent niche. And it's one that I'm actually going to personally get involved in soon.
I'm going to get bitten for saying this, but internet marketing still remains a good niche. I know that there are massive amounts of competition, and I know that everyone and their grandmas have a site about internet marketing, but if you can really do a good job, and you can come up with some kind of unique idea and pitch, it's still a profitable market.
Terry, so, what you really need to do is, since they are good markets, there is a lot of competition, so you need to develop your USP or unique selling principle to differentiate yourself and show people why you're different than anyone else in that industry.
Onik,
definitely.
Terry, and that's what you've done with Affiliate Classroom.
Onik,
yeah.
Most definitely, that's the most important thing in anything.
If you're going to be a merchant or an affiliate, you have to find your own unique edge.
Terry,
excellent. Onik, we have a whole bunch of questions. You and I both sent out to our list asking them what they would like to know about business and about affiliates. We have a mixture of questions that are about half affiliate and half business.
Before we get into that, I would just like to know, what is a day in the life of Onik Single like?
Onik,
a day in my life.
Well, besides all the college and moving around, if we focus on what the business part of my day is like, I do a massive amount of emails. My thing with emails is that I like to get to them right away because if I don't, they really add up. Once they add up to a certain degree, I just don't want to answer them anymore because there are too many.
Terry.
Is this something you do at the end of the day?
Anik.
No, I do it all throughout the day. This is a bad habit, and I've listened to Frank Curran talk about it. He has a strict policy where he only looks at his email in the morning and in the evening. My thing is, something always comes up in the evening. One of my friends will call me up and say, I'm going to a bar. You should come. I just say, screw these emails, and I'm gone. So, I like to handle them throughout the day. If I'm working on something serious, then I put aside the email and look at it when I'm done with it. I love writing. Writing is one of my favorite things. I do most of my own content, especially in the whole internet marketing field, because it took so long to learn it, now it's neat to know stuff. I do a lot of chatting with programmer and my SEO guy, getting project updates. We have clients that we're working on, so I have to get updated on those. Right now, I'm working with a programming team to build up that script I talked about for site building. I spend a lot of time with them. I've been working on building content for Affiliate Classroom a lot lately. It seems like I'm always doing some form of interview or something to put into that site. Then, if I have time left over from all of that stuff, I love to do marketing and look for new places to advertise for my various websites. Another thing that I love doing, especially in the internet marketing niche, is emailing new people. I might be in a forum, see a guy that I've never talked to before, go to his site, and shoot him an email. For me, that's just a networking tool. So, I'm not too good about it, but I'm trying to get better and better about it. The last thing is trying to work with affiliates. Considering that we train affiliates on how to be affiliates, I think I should work hard on making sure that our own affiliate program is the best possible. So, I've been spending a lot of time lately working with our affiliates.
Terry.
Excellent. That's super.
So, we'll open up the questions and get things going. The first question is from Amar, and he says, how do you succeed as an affiliate with so much stiff competition? What strategy do you adopt to become number one?
Anik.
That's a great question. He's right, most people's number one concern is how to do it because there is so much competition. One way around it is that you need an edge or something unique about yourself, like we talked about already, so that when somebody comes to your site, he'll come back. Another thing is, focus on content. On the internet, people are looking for information, and not all of them want to spend money immediately. So, focus on providing them some of the information for free, and then tell them where they can get the rest of it. That's my form of what I call pre-selling. I'm going to drill this one more time, have an upsell. You'll have much more success if you have an upsell because all of a sudden one customer is worth 10.
Getting a new customer is hard, but selling more to the same one is easy. Focus on search engines as well.
If you really want to dominate a niche and be a successful affiliate marketer, you can't do it without search engines on your side.
Terry.
Excellent. Next question. An anonymous person wanted to know, what affiliate marketing methods or strategies do you have that you find to be the most effective in building long-term, passive income?
Anik.
When I think long-term, I think he or she means that I do some work for it now, and I get paid long-term without having to do work over and over for it. So, the number one thing is search engines. The reason is that you'll spend a couple of months now, but you're going to receive payment from that for years. The next area would be to set up one of those 20-part email messages that I talked about earlier. What's happening is that 20-part email message might go out over the course of 6 months. So, during all of that time, your autoresponder is sending out emails for you without you even knowing about it.
Third strategy is link trading, which I talked about already. Links bring a lot of long-term traffic, so that's an excellent area.
The fourth one, I'd say, is that you should focus on selling products that have a recurring income, like membership sites. If an affiliate promotes Affiliate Classroom and gets a member, on the first tier they're going to make $10 a month on the life of that member. So, they can start making $1,000 a month by referring 100 members. All they have to do is sell 100 people one time, instead of selling 100 people every month. The last one that I always say is having two-tier programs. I recently read a report that talked about if you're a beginner affiliate marketer, an excellent strategy for you to do is to find two-tier affiliate programs and pump those people into you have no website, no list, no money to advertise, nothing. What I do is find a second-tier affiliate program and find people who have websites and have all of that stuff that I don't have, and I talk to them and say, I see that you have a website on this topic. Have you heard of this guy? Your guys might like his product. I have it and I think it's great. You should try it out. That guy might think it's good and join under your link. You're then going to make second-tier commissions on all of his work. So, that's a good way to set up long-term income because once he's recruited under you, he's permanently your second-tier for life. So, whatever business he does, you'll get paid on it.
Terry.
And you don't need anything except to contact that guy.
Onik.
Yeah.
Just email or phone him.
That's all you need.
Terry.
Beautiful. The next question is from Marcus and he wants to know, what is the most important piece of software for affiliate marketing?
Onik.
When I saw that, I thought about it for a while, and I'm going to have to say, if he just wants one, AdWord Analyzer. The reason for that is that I use that software 5 times a day minimum. Whenever I get a new niche idea, let's go back to our dog health idea.
I'll type in dog health into the analyzer.
It'll type out 200 or so keywords that are related, and for each keyword, it gives me the number of searches, number of websites on that keyword, the number of Google AdSense running, and the number of overture ads running for each keyword. So, in 2 seconds it built my whole website for me, because I can look at it and see that the niche has a high demand, but it only has 8 Google ads so I can compete and I can buy cheap pay-per-click traffic. Or, I can see that it has 150 Google ads. That's extremely competitive, maybe I don't want to get involved. So, that's a quick way to check out a niche.
Terry.
Beautiful. Next question, from D, says, I understand that articles will help get traffic and your name out there. What I want to know is, how do you write an article for a niche that you know little about, without sounding like a twit?
Onik.
You have to do a lot of research. You have to read up on that material, that's a given. Don't try to write something about something that you don't know because you will quickly get called out for it. You don't want to mislead people also, because that's unethical. So, do research and write about it, or pay someone on Elance to write you one. I don't like to hire writers that are too cheap, but it can be done. In the beginning, if you're just looking for quantity versus quality, then that's fine. You may end up hiring a writer who's really good at researching or knows about that topic. They'll tell you that when you post on Elance, they'll tell you if they already know a lot about the topic.